So, good day everyone. For today, we're going to discuss about the introduction to e-governance for development administration. So, the introduction to e-governance in the context of development administration involves the utilization of information and communication technology to enhance governance processes and public service delivery. So, e-governance aims to make a government operations more efficient, transparent, and citizen-centric. No, it passes various initiatives such as communications delivery, digital communication channels, and data-driven. So in the realm of development administration, e-governance plays a role. Okay. Of course, play a critical role, no? And particularly, of course, in bridging the gap, no, between the government and citizens, no, particularly in different countries, no, where traditional governance systems may be inefficient or inaccessible to many. And one key aspect of e-governance for development administration is the provision of online services, which enables now citizens to access government services and information conveniently from anywhere, anytime. And this can include services related to healthcare, education, public utilities, and administrative procedures like obtaining license or permits. So by digitizing these services, governments can streamline processes, no, reduce bureaucratic tape, no, or red tape, and improve overall service quality. So moreover, e-governance facilitate better transparency and accountability in government operations by making information more readily available to the public. So through online portals and open data initiative, citizens can access government budgets, policies, and performance data, allowing the greater scrutiny, no, and participation in the government process. And this transparency helps in curbing corruption, no, and fostering trust between the government and citizen. And to give us more details about topic, let us all welcome our presenter. Go ahead.
Thank you, Paul, for the comprehensive introduction, Dr. Bache. So again, good afternoon, po, classmates. My name is Justin Africa, and my report is about the introduction to e-governance for development administration. Po, huwag lang natin pansinin yung picture dito sa baba kasi nalagay po yan yung record ko kanina. Hindi ko lang matanggal kasi mabagal yung computer right now. Anyway, to proceed, here are the learning intended outcomes. So, mentioned by Dr. Abante, the topic here that the introduction would include getting an overview, a general understanding of what we mean when we say e-governance. Next, we will also look at how technology is used in public administration. We will look at analyzing the impact of e-governance in bringing more efficient services to the public and also help with how it will help in decision-making and policy implementation. Governance models and frameworks will also be included in the introduction, as well as policy and legal aspects. We will also hear a little bit about how digital transformation relates to e-governance. And there will be a few points about challenges, opportunities, case studies. We will also hear about how e-governance encourages more citizen engagement and participation and how it can support sustainable initiatives. Also, there will be a few there will be some information about ethical considerations and future trends. Okay, so let's start by really looking at what we mean when we say e-government, governance, and e-governance. So First, with e-government, according to the Global E-Government Readiness Report of 2004, it is the use of information and communications technology and its application by the government for the provision of information and public services to the people. And the using e-government, through e-government, processes will be more streamlined, workflows can be more integrated because of the benefits of using technology. Right? Also, the technology can help in managing data and information, expanding and improving communication channels, which is to bring information to the people more quickly, more rapidly. Also, not only with the public, but also with other agencies in the government for better collaboration and cooperation. Because of e-governance, the citizens can be more engaged and more empowered. And overall, it's all about improving public service delivery. Now, as you have all heard before, I work for the government of Quezon City. And here are a few of the examples of services available to the public through the e-services of Quezon City. So you can see that people can use the e-services website to apply for the Pew Citizen ID, which is an ID issued by the city that people can use as they avail of services provided by the city. Yan lang po yung pinapakita. For example, if you want to ride the libreng sakay, your QC bus, you just need to show a QC citizen ID and you can use that mode of transportation. Also on e-services, another example is the online business permit application system, right? So here, businesses can submit new applications or renew their existing permits. Nandito din yung services for your property taxes, scholarships, yung mga financial support for businesses or for displaced workers, lahat po yan and many more can be accessed through the QC e-services website and application. Moving to governance, it is the exercise of political, economic, and administrative authority in the management of a country's affairs, a country or a locality's affairs. It also includes citizens' articulation of their interests and exercise of their legal rights and obligations. So it's all about the work that government agencies do. And also the second part of it is the engagement, how people interact with the government, how they are able to avail or benefit from the services from the government, right? Also, this can include the interaction, the collaboration, and the coordination between different agencies within the government at different levels and also with other institutions outside the government. So that's all under the umbrella of governance. Now, moving to e-governance. Earlier, we heard about e-government. So when it comes to e-governance, this is more comprehensive because it's not simply about service delivery. It now is expanded to the overall governance using technology in a lot of different aspects of governance. So that includes using technology to manage data, to make policy data-driven decision making and policy formulation, right? Through technology, governance can be more efficient, speedy, transparent. The accessibility of public services is very much improved because of technology. This is why governance becomes e-governance. People, the public are now more involved in decision making. They can attend consultations. They can also attend other meetings and voice their concerns, share their needs, so that these can all be part of the consideration when decisions are made in the government. Right? So overall, e-governance affects, the use of technology affects and improves, you know, makes enhances how individuals can interact with the government or how the government itself operates. Okay, so there's a wide scope when it comes to e-governance. A lot of the ones you see here have been mentioned by Doc Melo earlier. But right now, we will also take a look at a few short examples and descriptions for each of the different aspects of e-governance. So the first one is service delivery. So this we hear a lot. It's more convenient. Now, technology makes availing public services more convenient. Examples, like I said earlier, under e-government, filing your tax returns, applying for licenses, permits, and certificates is more easy. You no longer need to go to your government office to apply for this, and the payment can also be made online. So it's faster, more convenient, more cost-effective. Next is digital communication. So through technology, it's easier to interact. The interaction is easier. The interaction between citizens and the government is faster. Information can be shared instantly. There's also a concept called e-open government, where information is distributed more openly between the government and the citizens, corporations, through online platforms, mobile apps, social media, email, and the official websites of government agencies. Next is citizen engagement. So earlier na mentioned rin po kay Conter, yung online consultations, surveys, feedback, online forums, so that the public are essentially more involved. They are able to participate in the decision-making process. They can speak exactly about their concerns, what's happening in their community, so that these can all be heard by the administrators, and they can come up with more targeted solutions. Next is efficiency, administrative efficiency. Because of the simplified and streamlined process, within the government operations, because of automation and the reduction of red tape, this all results in better efficiency in providing services and meeting the objectives of the government and the needs of the people. Next is transparency and accountability. So because data is openly shared, everyone, including the public, will have access to information through data, right? And because of this scenario, accountability is improved, right? Of course, the people managing the data has the responsibility to ensure accuracy. So they are accountable and they are in charge of making sure that the data is reliable. There's a decrease, no, potential in a decrease in the potential for corruption. So because information is open, people know what's going on, they can see if there are any anomalies in data. So this can be a deterrence for some forms of corruption, right? And next is data management. So gathering, storing, and managing data is part of data management. And this enables public sector organizations to make evidence-based decisions and policies, right? So it's not like past situations where some officials base their decisions on political conditions. Now, this is something that many people have heard about, but this time, because of e-governance, that situation, yung the one that I just described, will be greatly reduced, right? Kasi everything needs to be based on data, based on evidence, or ayun, para mas responsive, para mas mayroong real basis, scientific basis for policy making. Okay, next is interagency collaboration. So, like I said earlier, different government agencies, different offices at varying levels oftentimes need to collaborate, need to cooperate. So because of technology, this becomes easier. It's exchanging information among government agencies improves to better efficiency, better performance in meeting the objectives of the different offices. Next is accessibility, right? Because of technology, it is now more, more accessible. More people have access to technology that can be used, devices that can be used to access services online. So the whole design, the whole mindset of e-governance should be one that ensures that everyone in society has the same level of access to everyone. No one is left behind. Everyone can equally receive the attention of the government. Everyone can access all of the services that are available because of technology. Next is policy development. And technology has an impact on the formation and regulations regarding ICT, cybersecurity, data protection, digital infrastructure, and overall implementation of e-governance. And last is smart governance. And there's a lot of new technology, for example, AI, big data, blockchain, and Internet of Things. So these are new trends that have a wide array of different applications, different benefits that can be harnessed. So right now, there's a need to keep up with the new technology to harness, to maximize the benefits that you can get from all of this new technology. So it says here that e-governance is continually expanding because of advancements in technology. So this is very exciting because with new technology, everything's improved. Things can be done faster, easier, costs are reduced, and so on. So there's a lot of potential for great impact, greater impact, positive impacts if the government can harness all the functionalities of the new technologies that we've been shown. Okay, now we will take a look at a few points about the importance of e-governance in development administration. So we've been hearing a lot about efficiency, streamlined process, reduced red tape, online platforms allow people to access services, information anytime, anywhere. There's less need to visit offices, government offices. E-governance brings forth increased transparency and accountability, as we described earlier. Citizen participation and engagement is also improved. Decision-making is data-driven. There's a lot of savings when it comes to cost. Resources can be optimized because of reduced paperwork. There will be more savings. And the public funds can be used for other priorities. Also, another set of important aspects of e-governance is improved communication and information dissemination. So with rapid dissemination, real-time communication, the public can directly engage with the government. Better interagency collaboration, So this is about collaboration, about communication, coordination at different levels of government, better accessibility. Everyone can use the technology that's available. Support for sustainable development. So because of all the data available, decisions can be made with sustainability in mind. So that's another way for e-governments to support sustainable development goals. And last is adaptability and innovation. Because of new developments, there's a lot of new potential that has yet to be explored. Okay, now to maybe appreciate, to have a better understanding and appreciation of our current situation in the context of e-governance, we can take a few minutes just to have a look at the historical context. What were the things that happened in recent decades that led to our current capabilities with e-governance? So this timeline starts in the 1980s and early 1990s. This is when the Philippines started looking and seeing at the potential of using ICT in government agencies. They already understood as early as then how ICT can improve efficiency and eliminate corruption. Right? Corruption, so of course, aligned with the history of the Philippines, there was a lot of corruption at that time. So fortunately, they understood that technology can address those challenges. Now, in 2000, in the year 2000, RA number 8792, the e-commerce act of 2000, was enacted. And it is acknowledged electronic communications and signatures as legitimate means of communication and transaction. So this is also another significant milestone because this helps in faster processing of policies, decision making, and implementation. Nabawasan yung bureaucracy because of the technology. In 2000 as well, the e-government master plan was unveiled, and this is to revolutionize government service delivery and internal process using ICT. By the year 2011, the National Broadband Plan was initiated by the U.S. with help from the U.S. government. The plan aims to enhance the country's internet infrastructure and connectivity, again, to provide access for all. And then in 2012, the iGovField project was initiated to enhance service delivery by integrating existing government systems and establishing centralized ICT infrastructure. So as many of you may have noticed, ang daming mga iba-ibang websites and applications from the government. So good thing now that they are developing iGovField to integrate, you know, to consolidate all of that so that people will not get lost in navigating all of the government websites. They can use this one application to look for whatever they need from the government. Also, part of the historical context of e-governance are a few more milestones. So, nandito din yung government web portals and online services to give citizens access to services, information, make transactions, like what we said earlier. Another milestone is expanding digital services, right? Including online payment for added convenience, improved security. You know, people are now more confident in making online payments, unlike how it was just a few years ago where people were hesitant kasi baka mawala yung. So now with improvements in technology, talagang mas lumadali yung mga transactions. Public consultations are done using digital platforms. Access to health and education services also benefit from digital services. Open data initiatives, another important milestone. It increases accountability and transparency, open data projects, data collection managed by the government is accessible to the public. No, if there's no reason to hide the data, it's all available. Kung hindi naman confidential, anyone can access that for their own studies and analysis. Especially for transparency, available din yung data and information about budget. And this, again, deters corruption up to a certain level. Socio-economic data, initiatives related to infrastructure development are other examples of data that is open to the public. Adoption of emerging technologies, like we said earlier, there's a lot of potential. Hindi pa fully maximized, but developments are ongoing to see how far or how much can the current state of e-governance be improved to benefit, to improve efficiency in meeting objectives for the benefit of the public. Okay, so that ends the introduction. Thank you all for listening. All the information presented was taken from the book, E-Governance for Development Administration. Thank you again, and have a good day. The next reporter po is Doc JP, but I'm not sure kung nakarating na po siya dun sa bahay niya. She was traveling on his way back. Tama po ba, Doc JP? Yes. Pasunod. After that is Ma'am Yerlin. And the last for today is Aparecido.
Nandito na po ba si Miss Rita? Nandito naman po siya. Si Doc JP po kasi kakaland niya lang kaya hindi siya makapag-present.
Okay, I just want to give additional inputs na about the topic. E-governance facilitates better transparency and accountability in government operations by making information more readable, available to the public. So through online portals and open data initiative, citizens can access government budgets, no, policies and performance data, allowing for greater scrutiny and participation in the government governance process. Now, this transparency helps in curbing corruption and fostering trust between the government and citizen. And e-governance also promotes citizen engagement and participation in decision-making process. Now, digital platforms such as social media, no, online forums, and e-petition system provides avenues for citizens to voice their opinion. So provide feedback and contribute to policy discussions. So by incorporating citizen inputs, governments can make more informed and inclusive decisions that align with the needs and priorities of the population. E-governance enhances the efficiency of government operations through the automation of administrative tasks and implementation of digital workflows. So by digitizing processes such as document management, workflow automation, electronic communication, government can reduce paperwork, no, minimize errors, and expedite decision-making process. And this efficiency gains particular significance in the context of development administration, where resources constraint and administrative efficiency may hinder progress. In addition to improving efficiency, of course, e-governance can also lead to cost savings for both governments and citizens. So by shifting towards digital service delivery models, government can reduce the need for physical infrastructure and manpower, thereby lowering operational costs. Similarly, citizens can have can save time and money by accessing services online instead of having to visit government office in person. So it is important to recognize that the successful implementation of e-governance initiative requires overcoming various challenges, including digital divide, cybersecurity concerns, and capacity building issues. So in many developing countries, no, access to digital technologies remain limited, no, particularly in rural and marginalized communities, exacerbating inequalities in access to government services and information. Additionally, ensuring the security and privacy of digital data is paramount, no, to maintaining citizen trust in e-governance system. So e-governance presents immense potential for transforming development administration by leveraging ICTs to improve service delivery, enhance transparency, as I mentioned, and accountability, promote citizen engagement, and enhance efficiency and cost effectiveness. So, however, realizing these benefits requires concerted efforts to address the associated challenges and ensure that e-governance initiative and inclusive, secure, and responsive to the needs of the citizen. So I think that's it for this topic.